this video, I'm gonna share what helped me become a professional colorist and how you can take these rules and apply it to your workflow and land your next dream gig. And guys, I'm gonna be giving away a free power grade. All you have to do to win is subscribe to my channel, leave a comment below, and the winner will be announced in the next video. Congratulations, Brian. You're the winner from last week's video. Email me in the about page and I will send you your power grade. For those who didn't win, no worries. I'm gonna be showing you how to download a free LUT pack at the end of the video. It will include the bleach bypass, teal and orange, and a film-like black and white LUT. And on that note, hit the thumbs up if you're enjoying the content on the channel, subscribe for more awesomeness, and follow my Instagram page to get behind the scenes and other updates. Let's roll the intro. If this is your first time on this channel, my name is Qazi. I'm a professional colorist in LA. I run a virtual studio called The Post Village. Link is in the description. And guys, the point of this channel is to simplify color grading. And what I've learned in over a decade, I want to share those tips and tricks with you today. I started color grading seriously around 2009. And when I first started, I was grading based on what looked good to me. I didn't understand the scopes and I didn't care for it. Then I realized what a stupid idea that was. Because I wasn't using a calibrated monitor, my colors were just all over the place. So logically, I took a 180 and then I started grading only based on scopes. I mean, you could have just hide the image. I don't even care. I was just running off of the scopes. And you can probably imagine how that turned out. Then I became the LUT. I was applying LUTs left and right like there's no tomorrow. And then I felt miserable. I felt limited. And I thought my grading career was over. Until I created these three rules. All right, it was never that bad, but you get the idea. Just as being a filmmaker, if we're writing a script, we follow hero's journey in some shape or form. Well, color grading is no different. The point of my backstory was that a lot of the times when we're starting out, and even some professional colorists that I know, a lot of the times we look at color grading as a very technical thing. And we strip the human element out of it. But the problem is that color grading is very much essential to the storytelling. Being a colorist is like being a quarterback. Not really, but just bear with me. So how a quarterback has to analyze all his options before he launches that throw? Well, colorists have to do the same thing. If you get going on a job without a creative brief and you think that you can get it done faster and satisfy your clients, that's just not how it works. With these rules, not only you're going to be most efficient that you've ever been at your job, but it will also help you land your next job. First things first, have a comprehensive dialogue with the creative director or a person in charge. And easiest thing to do is ask for some samples. Most of the time they'll give you a mood board or a creative deck, or sometimes they'll give you some links to their favorite stuff. And that will help you avoid any misunderstandings along the way. So a couple of years ago, I worked on a very cool gig. It was end-to-end production. So we shot it, we edited it, and then we graded it. And for grading, they had a very specific idea. They wanted the ring look, like the monotone green sort of tealish look. And I was given everything. I was given the creative deck. I was given the color palette. I was given the sample images. And on top of it, I was given inspirations. So even after having all of that, I reached out to the producer and asked if I can get a one-on-one time with the creative director, which she agreed with, and we met for a cup of coffee. And honestly, after 5 minutes of just talking to the creative director, I realized that it was worth every penny. And not to mention, guys, most of all, we're in people business, okay? So the most important thing is to have that human connection, because as much as your skills and your badassery is gonna take you really far in your career, the key is, can I have a beer with you after work? It's that connection. Can I hang out with you? Because in our field, there is no wrong answer. It's subjective. So we have to think out loud. We have to build a bond with who we work with. So having that connection can take you really far. So that's genuinely one of the biggest tips that you can get out of this. So this was the intention. This was the shot that he wanted me to use as a reference for the entire campaign. He was beyond excited with the end product. We became friends while working on the job, and my company has worked with this client for the last 6 years. Number two, obstacle. Now that you know what to do, the challenge is, how do you get there? This is where you put your quarterback jersey on. Don't make the mistake of just jumping in and figure it out as you go. What you have to do is pick a hero shot. And hero shot is a clip that best describes your scene or your entire commercial. And then once we pick that shot, the next step is to play it back on a loop and analyze it. And guys, this is where you have to remember the intention. Stick with the plan and note anything that you want to change or improve that's gonna help your story, and avoid everything else. This right there will keep you focused and help you so much and save you so much time in the long run. I chose this as my hero shot. So here's the list of obstacles that I think we have to overcome in this particular shot. All right, so let's run through this a couple of times and then start taking some notes. So I already brought in our clip we're gonna be working with and our intention. So that's our shot. This is where we wanna get. We wanna take this to that. All right, let's get into this shot. I've already created a sequence. Let's watch it through a couple of times. Okay, so let's start going through it. So the most obvious thing is that I feel like she should be coming toward us, not going away from us. So we will flip that. And let's just play it back and analyze this. So that's a lot nicer. She's coming at us. I love that. Another thing we might have to do is maybe add some sort of a speed ramp to, like, you know, speed it up a little bit. With some bone crunching sounds, she's coming at us, some like grudge sounds, like it will like really sell the effect. Okay, so those are two things right there. We can cut the shot right before we see the slider. We can cut it somewhere around here. But the most important thing is that we have to get rid of these cords, all this situation that's happening in this area. Another thing that I'm noticing is that everything is just too sharp. I mean, this was shot on the OG Blackmagic camera with the Micro Four Thirds. And you can tell, I mean, I'm open all the way, but it doesn't even matter. Everything is in focus, because if I play the still from this, you can just see like how nice soft focus everything is in the foreground. And then as we get to her, she's in focus and it just creates that cinematic look, which we're not getting here. So we have to play around with that. Another thing would be very interesting is if we create some sort of like a cone-shaped lighting effect, right? So just think any torture cell scene in any movie, like, you know, there's an overhead light, you know, that's creating some sort of a light shaft. I also think it'll be really nice to add details, like see everything that's there. Like, you know, there's just so much detail in her face and these veins are just popping out and everything. And I feel like it would be nice to extract as much detail as possible.
Light shafts are always cool, and although there is no light coming through the window, it's coming from the top, I feel like we can cheat it and we can create some sort of like how, you know, with the Dutch angle, like everything is kind of moving in that direction. We can just have some sort of a light coming through. Another thing that can really help the story is if we add some sort of a flickering effect so the light can flicker a little bit. I feel like it would be nice to add film grain. And in this particular commercial, we can really, really go overboard and push it. So I think that's about it. I mean, those are the things, plain and simple.
Great, now we got a plan. Where should we begin? Systems and processes. You're gonna hear me use this term all the time, and there's nothing more important in life. But let's just stick to this project. What I mean by systems and processes in this situation is a node tree. Create a structure. What works well for you? Rinse and repeat. Do it enough times to build that muscle memory, and once it's locked in to your brain, you're gonna start flying through your grading sessions. Trust me, this will make a lot more sense when I take you through the grade in the next video, but let me give you the overview of the final image before we wrap up. So I started off with the noise reduction to send a clean signal through. Then I used my primaries to just dial in the global look as close as possible. Then we moved on to our secondaries, and that's where we fine tune and make finer adjustments. The layer below that was for sharpening to bring out the detail. Following that layer is for OFX, and that's where we used everything that was on our obstacle list. Next layer is for light modifiers, and this is where we were really able to control our light fall off to match the look. Following that layer is for our final adjustments, and this is where everything comes together. This all sounds impressive, but let's see if we really nailed our intention. Here's the final look. That wraps up today's video. Drop a comment below. Let me know if you found this helpful. Share your thoughts. And what do you think of the new setup? Time for some freebies. Link to the LUT pack is in the description below. And I'm gonna give you a quick rundown on how I use them. I built that look based off of a primary correction. So you still have to correct your image. Don't use it on a log image. Just fix your image a little bit, drop this LUT, and then see how it works. Guys, hit the thumbs up if you're enjoying the content on the channel, subscribe for more awesomeness, and follow my Instagram for behind the scenes and updates, and I will see you in the next video.